got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In Between. You got to spread joy up to the maximum, bring gloom down to the minimum. Have faith or pandemonium, liable to walk upon the scene.
Actually, I sang that song and I changed my mind. I don't know why I was so gloomy before, but I want to say I feel comfortable here in the UK with this particular book. In the United States, I have to do a lot of explaining. I have to say, all right, I know speaking out against positive thinking sounds twisted and mean, and it sounds like taking a stand against whole grains or motherhood or world peace or something. And I have to go through all of that. So I have to explain also that, you know, I am not against having a nice day or smiling at strangers. In fact, I wrote the last sort of historical book I wrote was called Dancing in the Streets, A History of Collective Joy. So nobody can accuse me of being a sourpuss. I wrote the book on joy. So what I'm going on after here is the American, and it is a distinctively American ideology, although we have been exporting it busily around the world, of positive thinking, by which I mean the idea that you have to be positive, optimistic, and cheerful. And if you're not feeling that way, then you better work on yourself until you get optimistic and cheerful. Damn it. Now, I first encountered this ideology, this kind of mandatory positive thinking, 8 years ago, when I was being treated for breast cancer. The diagnosis was, of course, a horrible shock. I had no known risk factors. Besides, I thought you had to have breasts to have breast cancer, but apparently exceptions are made. So my first thought was to reach out to other women, and it's mostly women who get this disease, for support and information. I went to all the breast cancer websites and I ordered all kinds of books. I was desperate for sisterhood. Supportive sisterhood. That is not, however, what I found. First thing I found, pink ribbons. Pink ribbons everywhere. Now, you have some of this here. I know. I've seen that picture in, I guess it's today's paper, Observer. One of the things that scared me right away was finding, when I was actually in the doctor's office waiting for the grim diagnosis, reading the local newspaper and finding in the classified section an ad for a pink breast cancer teddy bear. Now, that was an existential moment for me, because I realized right then that I'm ready to face death. I'm not afraid of death. I am terrified, though, of dying with a pink teddy bear tucked under my arm. And you know, there's I don't want to go off on the whole breast cancer thing, but there is this infantilization of people with breast cancer that goes on. Another example was at that time there was a foundation in New York City that was giving special little tote bags to any woman who was being treated for breast cancer, and I managed to get hold of one of these tote bags, though I was not in New York. And it had all kinds of some little, you know, moisturizers and skin cream and little cheap rhinestone jewelry, things like that, and a box of crayons. So I called the foundation. I said, this is really a nice thing that you're doing, you know, giving out these presents to women who are being treated for breast cancer. But what's with the crayons? And the answer I got was, well, That's just in case you want to, you know, express or write down some of your thoughts. I said, I am a writer. We no longer use crayons. And I was just shaken. Men are treated with somewhat more dignity. I mean, when they're diagnosed with prostate cancer, they are not given gifts of matchbox cars. And now, beyond the pink ribbon stuff and the teddy bears, there was this mandatory optimism, constant exhortations to think positively about the disease, in fact, to embrace the disease. It turns out that breast cancer isn't a problem, not even an annoyance. It is a gift in this ideology, a gift to be experienced with heartfelt gratitude. There's a book in the United States, I guess you could get it here too, called The Gift of Cancer. There you can even get online and order yourself a t-shirt that says, "Thank you, cancer." This is not how I felt. Gratitude was not my feeling. In fact, I would say, if cancer is your idea of a gift, get me off your Christmas list. So as an experiment, I went to one of the major breast cancer website in the United States, which is that of the Komen Foundation, and I decided to enter into the discussion on the message board. And I wrote a little entry under the subject line, angry. Now, I don't think I sounded too crazy. I mean, I very calmly said I thought that there was something really wrong here. We have a major epidemic. We don't know what causes it. Why is that? I had something really wrong here that we have such a common disease and the treatments for it are so debilitating and unpredictable in their results. And then, of course, you wouldn't understand this. I went on about health insurance companies, et cetera. Well, I instantly got responses saying to me I had to get over my bad attitude. One woman wrote to me and said, quote, "You need to run, Barb, not walk, to get some counseling." So, as I quickly learned, there was actually an urgent medical reason for being happy about having cancer. And that is, and you will this is still said today, that a positive attitude is essential to recovery. Again and again, I would hear this. Whether you get better or not, don't judge the treatments. It's all dependent on your attitude. This remains pretty axiomatic today, and not just in the case of breast cancer. People with any sort of cancer will be told this, well, you know, just look at it positively, and if you want to get over it. Now, how does a positive attitude fight cancer? Supposedly, by boosting the immune system. And then the immune system fights the cancer. Well, I have a PhD in cellular immunology. Do not mess with me about the immune system, all right? Because here's some facts here. There is no evidence that the immune system fights cancer. Strange, right? You probably thought it did. But the immune system evolved to fight foreign invaders to the body. Microbes, for example. Cancer cells are, sorry to say, our own body cells. There is furthermore no evidence that a positive attitude boosts the immune system. In fact, there is some evidence now, and this is really strange, that the immune system may, under many circumstances, actually promote tumor growth. And more to the point, now we have the big studies, looking at all the other studies, the meta studies, that have found that there is no evidence of an effect of your attitude on whether you survive cancer, breast cancer, lung cancer, neck cancer, a number of them. The research has been done as of 2007. But there I was in 2001 being told, essentially, that if I didn't recover, it was going to be my fault because I wasn't positive enough. So that was my first encounter. And I have to say, it's kind of strange that was my first encounter, but I live a sheltered life. I'm a freelance writer. I don't go out of my house to work unless I'm doing research. I don't go to church unless it's some kind of, you know, secular coven like this meeting, or anything like that. And I began then to see how ubiquitous this is in American culture. There is no problem that cannot be solved with your attitude and your thoughts. None at all. There are hundreds of self-help books available telling how you can attract money to yourself, for example, simply by thinking about it. Here's the cure for poverty. You know, I've, as an activist, poverty is probably my biggest subject. There's a cure all the time. All the time, just people had to attract the money to themselves. The only obstacles lie in your mind. Now, in fact, in the last decade and a half, a whole industry has grown up within the United States, and it has spread to the UK too, to promote positive thinking, usually in the form of motivation. That's our term for it. You can buy it in a traditional book form, CDs, CDVDs, or you can opt for the more intense experience of hiring a life coach, not a therapist anymore, life coach, or you could attend a week-long motivational seminar along with some famous motivator or positive thinking guru. One of these turned out rather badly recently. I guess it was late September, there was a motivational weekend or positive thinking weekend going on with a rather famous motivational speaker, James Arthur Ray. You might not have heard of him, in New Mexico. And he took all these people to a special resort in New Mexico where they were to, you know, start attracting things to themselves that they wanted. And one element of this was the sweat lodge experience. Now, it got too hot, and people began to scream and try to get out of the sweat lodge. And James Arthur Ray said, no, stay in it. It's your thoughts. Master this with your thoughts. And three of them died. And he is still a free man. Or you can acquire positive thinking in different object forms. There's a company in the United States called Successories, which is devoted entirely to uplifting motivational products. You know, calendars, little mugs, things you put on your desk. Then more recently, a canny retailer has invented, and I don't think you have this yet, the Life is Good line of products. You don't have these, huh? Oh, wow, here's an opening, a market opening. I mean, there's just all kinds of things like for the tire cover that you put on the back of your Jeep, it says life is good, your t-shirt says life is good. You know, it's everywhere. There are stores devoted entirely to life is good goods. I don't know why it gets to me so much, but I was in the grocery line not too long ago in the place where I live in Virginia, and noticed the man behind me in line had a t-shirt on that said, life is crap. And I thought, my man, you know? What a pickup line. But, you know, and he told me that it was a response to the life is good stuff. Anyway, the trouble is that this is not entirely voluntary, being positive, not in the United States. Those who don't adopt the positive manner, you know, and way of acting, may find it imposed upon them, especially in the workplace. Workplaces make conscious efforts to instill this kind of the required attitude in their people. Bringing motivational speakers, that's the obvious thing. They bring in a speaker who pumps up everybody. You probably had a lot of that goes on here too, admit it, right? Right? Somebody's experienced this at work. Or, you know, the motivational books, positive thinking type books, may be distributed free of charge by your employer, like the one in 2001, the mega bestseller, Who Moved My Cheese? You've heard of that, okay? Yeah, Who Moved My Cheese? Employers would just give that out free and then require workers to come and discuss it. And you know what Who Moved My Cheese was about? It was about Yeah, you're going to be downsized. Get used to it. Don't complain. You know, that was clear and simple. In fact, it was the era of downsizing, beginning in the 1980s, that led U.S. corporations to start investing in positive thinking in a big way, for two reasons. One is to quell dissent among the layoff victims. They did a very good job of that, you know, but by telling them, hey, it's not so bad to lose your job, it's a great thing. It's an opportunity. It's a transition, you know. And the second point of all this positive thinking in the corporate workplace was to squeeze more and more out of the people who are left behind, out of the survivors. Because now you have to have people who work, do the jobs of two people or three people instead of one. Now, you can see the parallel to breast cancer, between the cancer and the layoff victim situation. You take people who are going through something really bad in their lives, and you tell them, it's not bad at all. It's an opportunity for growth. Or, you know, in the case of breast cancer, you're supposed to become more evolved and more spiritual, even more feminine as a result of the breast cancer. It didn't work for me. It actually made me nastier and meaner than before. Or you can tell them that the cure for the problem is positive thinking. And in the case of, I mentioned that in the case of cancer, but in the case of job seekers, they are told again and again, you're not going to get a job because of what you can do or because of your education or your skills or your experience. Being hired depends 90% on attitude. I can't tell you how many times that has been said in my presence by motivational speakers. And this is probably true in America. By the 90s, all the business advice books were advising employers to eliminate, quote, negative people. Are there negative people in your workforce? Get rid of them. Anybody here ever been told at work that they were too negative? Wow. All right, well then, I guess it's all over, yeah. And it can mean negative, and I'm sure you know, can mean asking too many questions. Or maybe expressing a doubt about somebody's brilliant plan. You know, maybe it won't turn out that well. That's being negative. So you have to, you know, you can't get rid of that. You can get fired for that in the United States. You can be fired for just about anything in the United States, but you'd be obviously fired for being negative. And similarly, and this is really kind of gruesome, there are breast cancer support groups that reportedly have expelled those members of the group whose cancer metastasized. You know, because why have them bring you down? You know, what a bummer. But I think the big thing that keeps people going for this positive thinking is the promise that it will do great things for you. You can have anything you want by focusing your mind on it. That's the promise. Because the universe exists to do your bidding. I bet nobody in a sermon has said this up here before, but anyway. If only you learn to harness your powers, you can have whatever you want. In fact, in a lot of this literature, the universe is referred to as a, quote, big mail order department, close quote. If you send in your orders clearly and unambiguously enough, fulfillment is guaranteed in a timely fashion. And this was the premise of that 2006 best-selling book, The Secret, which I know you read here too. Admit it, you know, Rhonda Byrne's book, The Secret, that you could have anything, you could just pull it to you with your positive thoughts. You know, she had in there, either in her DVD or her book, a woman who covets a necklace in a jewelry store window. And so she manifests it in her own, you know, to herself. She gets it. We call that breaking an entry generally, but that is that is also called the law of attraction, just attracting things to yourself. It's amazing. She has a case. Another woman wants to find a boyfriend. She wants to get a man. And so she just sort of says, okay, I got one. You know, mentally, she says, I got one. And she clears out half of her closet and half of her garage. And sure enough, some guy shows up. I am not surprised. The way the economy is going in the United States, you know, they barely need the couch. And they will come. They will come, believe me. There are many ways to attract things to yourself. You can, you might want to say affirmations repeatedly. Like this is from a book called, another bestseller, Secrets of the Millionaire Mind. And this is on how to get rich. And I'm going to tell you, I'm quoting now. Place your hand on your heart and say, I admire rich people. I bless rich people. I love rich people, and I'm going to be one of those rich people too, close quote. If you're a Christian evangelical, you can use God as an intermediary in getting you whatever you want. Not by praying, interestingly enough, but by assuming that God is ready to go to work for you as a personal assistant and get for you those things you want. I attended actually one of America's, the largest mega church in America, which is Joel Osteen's church in Houston, Texas. About 40,000 people come on Sunday mornings. It's in a former basketball stadium, so a lot of people can fit. And he doesn't talk about prayer, he talks about visualizing what you want and how it will come to you. And he gives many examples like of things he's gotten able to get, like a really good parking place. You know, just send that message out. These mega churches are pretty fascinating. I've been to a lot of them doing research on one thing or another, and I have to admit, I'm an atheist, so I don't have a lot of familiarity with what exactly is going on in these places. But the odd thing about the megachurches, even to a non-believer, is there are no religious symbols anywhere. No crosses, no images of Jesus, nothing like that. Well, in Joel Osteen's megachurch, you can find crosses in the gift shop. But there's no other crosses, you know, the main sanctuary, nothing. Looks like the United Nations or something. And there's a reason for that. If you think about it, the whole story of Jesus, that's such a downer. You know, the secret of the megachurches is that they figured out people do not want to spend the one day of the week when they don't have to do errands or go to work. They don't want to spend it being made to feel bad about themselves or anything else. So you just go for this wonderful message about, you know, how you can have everything and how God wants you to be rich. God wants to, what is the word they use? God wants to favor you with wealth. Now, you may be thinking, well, what's wrong with this? What's wrong with all this positive thinking? Even if there's no basis for it, I mean, why should anybody be so Grinch-like as to say, there's something wrong with this? If people want to sort of whip themselves up into a good mood, what's wrong with it? If you want to believe that God wants you to be rich or whatever, why should we get in the way? Well, I'm going to say two things that are wrong with it. And one is, delusion is always dangerous. These are delusions. They're comfortable delusions, maybe nice delusions, but delusions are always dangerous. You know, many, and the example I want to give of that in the case of positive thinking is the financial meltdown of 07 and 08, 09 for all I know. Now, many things contributed to that financial meltdown, which is obviously beyond our scope today, like the unfettered greed of the finance industry in the United States and in the UK, enormous inequalities in wealth, and an economy in the U.S. increasingly based just on financial services rather than on any manufacturing, et cetera. But I would also say that this American habit of mandatory optimism also contributed to it. First, it was everywhere among the economists. It was hard in 2006 or even 2007 to find anybody who would say, for example, that someday housing prices might go down again. They were all saying housing prices will always go up, stock prices will always rise, the business cycle is over. We've reached this state of perpetual ascent, A-S-C-E-N-T, going uphill. There was also this optimism on the part of millions of ordinary people. Positive thinking is part of what encouraged so many people who couldn't afford it to take on unsustainable amounts of debt. On credit cards, on a second mortgage, on an adjustable rate mortgage, or whatever. Now, debt has played a very important part in the American economy, probably more so than anywhere else in the world. Our solution to chronically low wages has been easy credit. And that went along with this message that, yeah, God wants you to have a bigger house. Joel Osteen has actually said that. You know, you deserve these things. And so when suddenly somebody came along from Countrywide Mortgage Company or Wells Fargo Bank and said, we know you've never been offered credit before because your wages are too low or your credit history is too bad or something like that, but we've got the mortgage for you. It must have seemed to a lot of people as if, you know, it's true what the mega church pastor said. God was reaching right down to make sure you got that larger house you needed. But more than the ordinary people who were drawn into this, sometimes with the complicity of their own churches, I would mention, I blame the corporate culture that America has and has been exporting around the world too, and this ideology of positive thinking that had taken over the whole corporate culture. For example, Countrywide Mortgage Company, which is arguably the company that brought down the whole subprime crisis, has been described by a former senior vice president there as operating as a kind of cult, you know, with everybody high-fiving each other, and where it was impossible to say, I'm a little worried about our subprime exposure. Now, to speak out in the corporate world up to the time of the meltdown, including the finance sector, was to risk being fired. When I talked to one high-level Wall Street banking analyst who had tried to warn his superiors in 2005 and 2006, he said anybody who voiced negativity was thrown out. He was told to shut up if he wanted to keep his job. The man who was in charge of the fixed asset division of Lehman Brothers, which of course is defunct now, warned his CEO in 2006 that it looked like the housing bubble was about to burst, and he was promptly fired for being so negative. So why didn't people see it coming? Because anybody who saw it coming was eliminated or silenced, because it was impossible to say negative things within this corporate world. Now, I have another problem with positive thinking as an ideology. It's mean. It's cruel. In fact, some people in the cancer care business have begun to speak out against what they're now calling the tyranny of positive thinking. I'm talking about people like oncology nurses who have, in some cases, said, this operates like an additional burden on a person who is sick. Not only is he or she sick with cancer, but in addition, they've got this problem of a bad attitude that they've got to, you know, do something about. And you know, I've heard from so many people who said, yes, I watched my wife die or whoever died in my family feeling dreadful to the last that they were not able to summon the positive attitude that would have been able to save them. The cruelty of it was well expressed by Rhonda Byrne, the author of the book The Secret, when she was asked to explain the 2006 tsunami. Now, how could bad things happen like that? Well, she said, and I'm putting it in so many words here, that what had happened was that people in the tsunami-struck areas must have been sending out tsunami-like vibrations into the universe. Now, she didn't just say, you know, they asked for it, but, you know, you got to watch what you're sending out. I think it's very cruel to the victims of economic hard times. Telling people, for example, that if they're poor, it's because they're inwardly resisting wealth, or that they haven't been working hard enough to visualize wealth. I've seen so many unemployed people quoted in the newspapers in the United States saying they've been out of work now for months, years maybe, and they say, but I'm doing my best to stay positive. And I want to shake them and say, don't bother. Why not accept that you've been victimized by forces that are beyond your control and allow yourself to feel anger? And if we have an economy that seems to have so little use for so many people's skills and talents and experience, that's a reason to be angry, I think. Now, the alternative to positive thinking is not negative thinking. In fact, negative thinking can be pretty delusional, too, if you want to be convinced that everything you attempt will turn out poorly, that everything that you do will not be fun. Well, that's your own kind of delusion. I would like to suggest a bold, radical alternative to both positive and negative thinking, which is realism. Trying to figure out what is actually going on in the world and what we can do about it. Which may mean, in many cases, with the kinds of issues that concern me, building movements to fight for social change, to work against impoverishment and unemployment and so on. But then you might ask, well, how do you ever motivate people to do that if you don't use positive thinking? And I have a very old-fashioned answer to that, a very old-fashioned idea of determination, a very old-fashioned idea of courage. And I would like to give you one example from American history. I hope I don't raise any hard feelings here, but going back to the founding fathers of America, when they signed the Declaration of Independence, they knew they had no certainty of winning a war for independence, and they also knew they had a good chance of dying. Just signing that declaration made them traitors to the crown. Treason was a crime punishable by death. Now, some of those signers went on to lose their lives and their property and their loved ones. The point is, they knew that risk and they fought anyway. And that's the philosophy, my school of life sort of philosophy for this morning, that I try to apply to many of my goals, which may seem very distant in the area of, you know, social justice and economic justice. I don't know if I'm going to succeed or if we're going to succeed in our lifetimes, but we're going to give it the best try we can and have a good time trying. Thank you.